So good morning, all of you. My name is, as you can read, Jan van Impe from the Catholic University of Leuven, Belgium. We are now based on the Technology Campus in Ghent, representing today the biotech team, bioprocess technology and control. And as you can read from the first slide, this year we exist 25 years. I will try to go with you through a small presentation about multi-scale modeling, highlighting a bit what we actually do in the team. Before this, I will shortly introduce our team. As I mentioned already, we are based on the campus in Ghent, lovely city in Belgium, worth a visit, definitely. The team name is Chemical and Biochemical Process Technology and Control. If today or later on you want to contact us, you will see appearing website, email addresses. Feel free. Always nice to be in touch with all of you. Now, some time ago, at KU Leuven level, we started reorganizing whatever had to do with chemistry and biology in a few target areas. And as you can see in the group Science, Engineering and Technology, this was concentrating on four modern buzzwords, namely new eyes on smart materials, closing the atom cycle, creative with nature, and factories of the future. Now, as you can guess, most of you, I guess, know the biotech team. We are mainly oriented in this quadrant of this matrix, factories of the future, highlighting green engineering, process intensification, and process optimization. Now, our vision is to consolidate and strengthen our international research position, societal impact. We don't do everything, definitely not, but we try to focus on some specific areas in chemical and biological process engineering. That means that in our application domains, we have some axes. The first axis is chemical and biochemical reactions and reactors, waste and whatever has to do with waste valorization, wastewater treatment systems, biological and chemical systems, and predictive microbiology, basically the topic of today. Now, this is only possible over a period of 25 years if we keep supporting our long-standing methodological approach at the level of systems and control. In the team, we have a large activity in the domains of system analysis and simulation, identification of processes. A second area, process monitoring, and last but not least, process optimization and model-based control. All of this we organize in our research matrix. And as you can see, these are the pillars that I mentioned before, chemical and biochemical reactions and reactors, the waste-related stuff, and public health predictive microbiology topics. Horizontal, transversal research domains, system theory and modeling, identification of processes, monitoring, and optimization and control. So our PhD students, they either fill, say, a column, they work on the modeling, the monitoring and the control of a biological process going on in a bioreactor, or they focus on, for instance, optimization algorithms applicable to a lot of different processes, and then their PhD thesis is based alongside many different application domains. At present, the team consists of about 16 people, two full-time staff members, three postdocs, and about 12 PhD students. Now, today I'm going to talk about some topics in multi-scale modeling in predictive microbiology. This is part of a longer lecture series that we will put online later. Today is, say, an appetizer, a teaser, to tell you a little bit about multi-scale modeling and the concepts we try to validate in many of our applications. Thanks a lot to Bert for inviting us to give this presentation, and thanks to Alberto for chairing this cost action, meaning providing us a forum for distributing this to anybody interested in our activities. So let's concentrate a little bit today on multi-scale modeling concepts. As you know, in predictive microbiology, this domain is focusing on safety of food products, and these days safety is of major importance. Outbreaks of pathogens are not on a daily basis, but at least on a regular basis in the news. You see here a few examples. The domain is concentrating not only on pathogens, but also on spoilage organisms, and we try to develop mathematical models to describe what is happening. So the field of predictive microbiology concentrates on mathematical modeling of microbial dynamics, possibly under fluctuating environmental conditions. An application domain by excellence is food products, but is of course applicable to many different application domains, also in the pharma industry, the biological industry, the waste valorization industry. This type of models is definitely of use. And as I said, we want to control food safety, pathogen-related, and food quality, spoilers-related organisms. Specific use, as I said, in the food industry and related industries, the regulatory bodies, risk assessment in the food trade is another very important application domain. Now, we can concentrate in mathematical modeling on the complete food chain, the well-known concept from farm to fork. So we then concentrate on process on the farm, processing, distribution, and storage. And then we try to build models describing the complete process going from the farm, the processing, transportation, up to consumption at the local clients, at the local consumers. This means that we try to build a model describing the whole chain going from farm to fork and try to draw conclusions out of this. And this is very important because the level of detail that you can put in such models is of course limited, is less detailed than as compared to focusing on just one single step, for instance, the processing step. Here we can go into much more detail as compared to modeling the complete chain from farm to fork. It really depends on the specific application you have in mind and what level of detail you want to include in your mathematical model. Now let's concentrate a little bit first on the concept of multi-scale modeling and what do we mean by this in the context of predictive microbiology. As you know, we can start from a population of cells, and a basic assumption could be, and I emphasize it could be, that we consider the population as completely homogeneous. This means that we can represent the population just by one number. That means it is basically a black box. We don't know really what is inside the population. We consider all entities of the population as identical. And we represent the population by one number, say the biomass or the population, the biomass X or the population density N. If we start distinguishing a little bit more in between individuals, we have cells that are newborn cells, we have mature cells, we have active cells in their exponential growth phase, in their reproduction phase, then we start discovering more differences in between the population members. It could be that we have heat-sensitive cells, heat-resistant cells. It could be that we distinguish a continuum of a certain target variable that we try to model in our system. It means the black box becomes a little bit more gray. We see a little bit more of distinction in what we try to model in the microbial population. If we really want it much more detailed, then we can only do but focusing on just an individual cell as a member of heterogeneous population and describe the interactions of the cell with all of its neighbors. This is symbolized here. If on top of this, we also try to model with, say, for instance, metabolic networks, what is going on inside an individual microorganism, then we really try to elucidate all mechanisms at cellular level. This is the most basic level for the microorganisms. Then we try to obtain, of course, a white box model. As you can see, going from the black box to the white box, the level of detail gets higher. Of course, also the complexity of the model that we will need will become much higher. It really depends on the application, and I will come back to this later on in the presentation, what we mean by it depends on the goal of the mathematical model. If for industry, we want to model, for instance, the response of a microbial population to a heat processing, many of the models published today are in the category of black box models. This is in a way sufficient for many applications today. Black box. We do not explain the mechanism describing what is going on, the real mechanism of inactivation of the organisms. If we, for instance, distinguish in the population the different response between resistant cells and sensitive cells, then we have a more heterogeneous population. It could be a discontinuous with two categories, two classes, or it could be a continuum of responses. This we call a gray box model. We have already a little bit more insight in different reply response mechanisms of a strain to an inactivating input, for instance, an elevated temperature, the temperature T. If we continue, as I said, up to modeling the individual cell and interaction with its neighbors, including what's happening inside the cell, then we enter the domain of trying to obtain white box models describing all possible mechanisms. Then we have a full biological, chemical, physical understanding of what the cell is doing in interaction with its neighbors. This is what we call white box modeling. Now, as you know, people and many important scientists are still looking for the fundamental laws of physics underpinning the whatever material is around us. As long as we do not have this, finding the ultimate white box model is, of course, part of utopia. We will never reach it as it stands of today, but it can be, of course, a target of research. If we put all of what I have said so far on a scale of complexity, this is the scale, the physical scale, and this is a scale of fully empirical models, simple models, say described by just one entity, one number, the population density, up to a fully mechanistic model. This includes, the fully mechanistic models includes a high degree of description of the underpinning mechanisms in the individual cell. We go to the smallest scale, we describe a lot of mechanisms. This is really what we call the level of individual-based modeling, as many people in many different domains spend their time on. It is applicable, by the way, also to sociological effects, not only for microorganisms, but also for humans. It's part of economy, it's part of allocation of resources. This is really a fundamental paradigm in individual-based modeling. It's very useful. Object-oriented programming is one of the tools and the key issues that we use in this context. Population-based models, population balance models, quite popular in chemical engineering dynamics, also finding their way in biological applications. As I said, gray box models. We apply a bit of knowledge. We have categories of populations, growing cells, active cells. We have cells in the stationary phase, or we have resistant cells, we have sensitive cells. We categorize the homogeneous population in different subclasses of populations. We open a little bit the black box and we obtain a gray box model. And of course, the macroscopic deterministic population models, very popular in practice, not explaining a lot when it comes to models, but still quite useful for many applications. If it comes to complexity and number of equations, here we are dealing with, say, one differential equation. Here we are dealing with about five differential equations. Here we are dealing with up to 1,000 or even more differential equations associated with the number of parameters that we need to identify. Now, as I said before, I hope this is a little bit clear. Now, what is the concept of multi-scale modeling? It is, of course, being applied to many different fields, but what does it mean in the domain of predictive microbiology? I hope it is clear from the previous slides a little bit. I would like to turn now a little bit more into the modeling exercise itself and what are in essential ingredients, to say it in food terms, what are essential ingredients to come to a successfully validated mathematical model. Now, as you can see here, this is a scheme trying to harmonize whatever concept and whatever step is needed to obtain a decent mathematical model. Now, in this case, they're basically at the output, we have the validated mathematical model. What do we need as a start? Very important, forgotten so many times, we need an objective. We need a goal. Why do we build this mathematical model? It is not simply occupational therapy for our PhD students or for ourselves. This could be. Building mathematical models is a lot of fun, I can guarantee you. But they have some application. Is it basically to obtain more insights in the process? Is it a way of summarizing our knowledge about different processes? Or is it a tool that we will use to construct monitoring algorithms, to construct process control algorithms, to construct process optimization algorithms? This means that there is a different level of complexity involved. If we try to summarize all possible knowledge The model can become hugely complex, but totally useless in the context of process optimization, because the number of differential equations is too large to build any decent process control algorithm. Still, the two types of models exist, ranging, connecting a bit to the previous part of this talk, ranging from black box to white box models. It really depends what do we want to do with the model. Another side of inputs for constructing a mathematical model is the prior knowledge. Hopefully we have some. In biology, many times this knowledge is lacking. Basically because biology relies on chemistry and physics, and we still do not know any full detail. Of course, we are making huge progress in the field of molecular biology, but still there are quite some unknowns on the mechanisms of life as we know it on a micro scale and on a macroscopic scale. Prior knowledge, a very important input. Whatever knowledge we have available, we better try to include it in the mathematical modeling. Last but not least, extremely important experimental data. A model can be based just on experimental data. Then we try to find correlations between input data, as we call them, and output data. The quality of the data, the sampling interval, knowledge on the accuracy of the sensors that we have been using. These are already a first three, very straightforward, but essential to take into account characteristics, feature of the data that we try to model. Richness, information content in the data that we will use is of course extremely important as well. Suppose you want to model the suspension system of your car. It does not pay off to drive your car on the perfect highway. It will pay off to drive your car on a cobblestone road. This will excite the suspension system in your car, and the data that you collect at that moment will reveal the dynamics of the suspension system and of the car that is mounted on top of it. That means that there is the concept of persistence of excitation, and that brings us to the concept of optimal experimental design. A lot of data that we see published do not satisfy some basic constraints, some basic elements about information content buildup in experimental design in the data that we try to connect. If the model is simply based on input-output data, on data that we collected in the lab or available in the literature, we don't use any prior knowledge, and we typically will end up with a black box model. What we find, and this is no harm, no criticism towards black box models, but what we find is not explaining anything about mechanisms. It's a mere correlation between input and output data that can prove very useful in statistics, in risk assessment studies, in many different applications. It is simply not explaining the mechanism. It is just the data and insights that we see not with the naked eye, but that some advanced modeling techniques can reveal correlation between inputs and outputs. If we would have the full prior knowledge from the laws of physics and biology, then of course we will end up with the ultimate white box model. And this is then the left axis, the left stream of knowledge going through the modeling exercise. We start from prior knowledge, we analyze the knowledge, we do some mathematical steps in the frame definition, what kind of model will we use, we characterize the structure, will it be a nonlinear or a linear differential equation, what steps do we need to take to estimate the corresponding parameters, we try to validate the model, and finally we obtain the white box model. Keep in mind, these steps, the central trunk of the modeling exercise, is common to the white box modeling and to the black box modeling route. Of course, what happens in practice and what happens these days most often in biology and biologically inspired chemical engineering models is that we combine prior knowledge with experimental data to fill the gaps in the prior knowledge. And of course, merging these two routes ends up in a gray box model as we most often see it. Practical example, many mathematical models, also in predictive microbiology, are based on balance equations, mass balance, energy balance, whereas the kinetics, which is much more difficult to model, or based on experimental correlations based on experimental data collected in the lab. The mass balances represent, of course, the prior knowledge. We have to satisfy conservation laws. This is a principle in physics. The experimental data that we collect to determine the corresponding kinetics in the mass balances, these of course represent then the black box part. Altogether, we obtain a gray box model. 99.99% of the models we use today in many of the engineering fields and in many technological fields and domains, both in academia and industry, governmental bodies, all of these models belong to the category of gray box models. So I try to explain so far, going from a full population to an individual, or the other way around, the bottom-up approach, going from an individual to a homogeneous population, different concepts as at the level of macroscopic, more the black type kind of model, population-balanced models, individual-based models, approaching more and more from black box to white box models. Small example, after a lot of philosophical debate on black box and white box models, small example, a very popular model in predictive microbiology. The general expression for microbial evolution, you see it depicted here. I need to move a little bit the screen that I can follow myself. The variation of the population density is proportional to the actual population density. Proportionality factor we call mu, this is a specific growth rate. Now, if mu is negative, this means that the population density will decrease over time. This happens in an inactivation step, you see here, the natural logarithm to keep scales a bit decent, natural logarithm of population density as a function of time. You see that it's not a traditional straightforward, just a straight line, as we see it in inactivation studies, most often in pasteurization studies, we could have shoulder effects and tail effects. If the evolution over function of time is almost equal to zero, then we are at this line. This is a completely different type of model. We are then at the boundary of growth of the population and no growth of the population, which is a very essential concept for studies in risk assessments. Of course, in risk assessments, either most of the times related to pathogens. These days we also apply risk assessment to spoilers. We are most interested in conditions in our food product that keeps the product safe and not spoiled. Keeps the product safe, so that means that the stress factors need to be in this region. Completely different area of mathematical modeling and predictive microbiology. Last but not least, it could be a desired phenomenon that we have growth of the microorganism. For instance, we want to grow the yeast in our bioreactor to produce a lot of ethanol, which we can use in many alcohol productions or in fermentation processes. Yeast is also used in bread making and so on and so on. In a pathogen, in an application of food safety, of course, the growth of the microorganism, with the mu being positive, is of course an unwanted phenomenon. And then we have that DMDT is mu being positive. We describe a positive evolution of growth. And this is, of course, what we do not want if we want to avoid the people to get sick of the products that we eat in daily life. Let's focus a little bit on a very famous model, concentrating on describing the microbial growth at a constant temperature. And the dots are, of course, the experimental data. The full line is the fitting of a well-known mathematical model to fit these experimental data. And what I just said, we have experimental data, mind the time scale, this is hours. In microbiology, we are already quite happy if we have about a sample every half an hour. That's already a lot of work for the people doing this job in the lab. Secondly, we are talking about a relatively simple model, a continuous model here, drawn in red as a function of time. I will try to highlight a bit the main features of this model. Now, this is a description of the model. What do we recognize here? Dn over dt is a big factor times n. So all of this is the specific growth rate. But as you can see from the slope of this curve, it's again a natural logarithm scale as a function of time. The slope of the curve is not constant, meaning the specific growth rate, specific rate, dndt over 1 over n, put at the left side, you have the quantity mu, this mu is not constant over time. We need to represent what we call a lag phase. We need to represent the exponential phase where the organism is at full growth, at full reproduction, is at full metabolic activity, and finally the stationary phase. I will not go into the details, this would bring us too far, but you can see here that this factor Q is related to a metabolic initial state. We need to bring the machinery up to full speed, so this Q needs to grow at an exponential rate modeled by this equation, and then this factor, when Q is sufficiently large, will move into 1. At that moment, this factor becomes dominant. We have the mu max, we have the full exponential growth being developed. When N approaches the maximum population density, in a given environment, in given environmental conditions, there is a maximum population density. That means the population stops growing. N equals N max means the factor, this factor in total becomes equal to 0, the growth stops. This is a very elegant model. I give here as an example the N max corresponding to this one. It is a very elegant model, but what does it explain? Not much. It describes. It gives a posteriori a description of the well-known concepts in the microbial evolution. A microorganism passes the stages of a lag phase, starting up its metabolic machinery, the exponential phase, and the stationary phase. We do not explain why or how that machinery starts up. We do not explain what is the fundament of exponential growth. We do not explain why the cells go into their stationary phase. Still, the model, as we have seen it, is extremely popular and extremely useful in predictive microbiology. We call it a black box type, although we can give a biological interpretation to the parameters. A black box type that is at the basis of many predictive microbiology studies for food safety, food spoilage, and there exist similar models for inactivation, pasteurization applications, and so on. Coming back to the modeling exercise, we have been discussing these different steps. As I said, if we combine prior knowledge with experimental data, we end up with gray box models. There is the important issue of experimental design, as I touched a little bit on at the start of this little talk. Experimental design focuses on do an experiment so that we know or we can grasp out of what we collect that level of information, data, other pieces of information, the structure of the model that we need. Is it a linear model? Is it a non-linear model? Extremely difficult. Open problem these days in the scientific literature in systems and control. We can focus a much more developed domain on doing experimental design so that given the outlook of an equation, it is a differential equation of degree 5 and it contains 7 parameters in a non-linear way. We have 10 differential equations of this type. Collect experimental data so that we can estimate in a reliable way all the parameters. This is optimal experimental design, not for structure characterization, but in this case for parameter estimation. To give you just a feeling of what is happening here, why is it not possible to estimate parameters from any set, arbitrary set of data? The main reason is that the parameters that we try to estimate from an arbitrary set of data most often are correlated. This is the identification functional. It gives you a measure of the goodness of fit of the model. What we see here in this schematic is that any combination of parameters P1 and P2, parameters in the mathematical model, any combination along this line satisfies that we have an equal goodness of fit. We cannot find a unique combination, the true biological unique value of the parameters P1 and P2. So that means our data were not sufficiently rich. We cannot obtain unique parameter estimates. We need to focus on redesigning the experiment so that we obtain as a goodness of fit surface in terms of the two in this little symbolic example we are trying to estimate, of course, two parameters P1 and P2, that the goodness of fit objective function in the optimization problem, that is any parameter estimation problem, that the goodness of fit has a unique minimum. Meaning, if we have a first initial guess, and then we let our optimization algorithm search for the true combination of parameters P1 and P2, given this surface, we will automatically, with any decent optimization algorithm, be driven to the unique combination of parameters that we need. So optimal experimental design for parameter estimation is basically, in a philosophical way, about reshaping the goodness of fit surface so that it has a unique minimum in the parameters that respond to biological reality. Now, there's a lot of work going on in this domain, especially for nonlinear systems. There are still quite unknown problems to be solved. I will leave this for another occasion to discuss this in much more detail. So this was a little appetizer of multi-scale modeling concepts. Planning of experiments, I touched a little bit design of experiments. This is the more traditional way, Bob's Behnken designs, all of these. These we well know, this is already a first step, proof factorial designs, all of this. A step further is the optimal experimental design procedures, reshaping the goodness of fit cost index so that we obtain a unique minimum. All of these are a little bit beyond the scope of this introductory seminar, but you can already take home that designing optimal experiments is of course related to the complexity of the mathematical model. The more complex the mathematical model, the more parameters it will contain, the more difficult it gets to design a decent set of experiments to extract all of the parameters from the experimental data that we try to model and obtain decent, correct values out of the data that we have collected. The more involved the complexity, the more reliable may be the model, a white box model, but the more involved to obtain it and to estimate all of its parameters. Now to conclude, if you allow me a short advertisement, if you want to know more about what we are doing, we have been working on a book together with some colleagues in a network that was called QSAFE. It was in the lifelong learning program of the Erasmus Plus program of the EU. The book will be very soon on the market. I just give you a little bit what is the contents. It's of course about food safety, food spoilage, food quality. All of these concepts are extremely important. As you see here, a few figures illustrating this. Cost of US foodborne illnesses, for instance, is a decent number. In the book, we discuss the complete chain from production, processing, distribution, storage, up to consumption with the consumers, as I mentioned already. What is the content of the book? We concentrate, of course, part of it. This is our input. We contributed with 6 different teams to this book, to food microbiology. This is our domain, foodborne illnesses. I have to read this little screen again. Foodborne illnesses, food spoiling, we try to focusing on. Predictive microbiology is explained in detail, how to collect experimental data, plate counting, for instance, as a technique, or optical density techniques, and so on. We explain models for lag phase, exponential phase, stationary phase. We concentrate and we spend a complete chapter on the multi-scale modeling concepts as it was explained during this introductory talk, the multi-scale modeling in predictive microbiology. The type of models that we use, stoichiometric models, metabolic network models, basically in systems biology, individual or agent-based models, population balance models, up to the microscopic population level model. The simple model DNDT is mu times N that I tried to explain a few slides ago. Topics in the book. We focus on modeling in bioscience and food. We focus on risk assessment and we focus on life cycle analysis. Software is included, exercises and solutions all provided on a USB stick. You see here a few introductory pages of chapters on theory, tutorials, exercises, always with the key to the solution or the full solution included. Our contributions in this book are in the domain of predictive microbiology, introduction, multi-scale modeling, the macroscopic approach, I gave an example today, the mesoscopic and the microscopic approach up to metabolic networks, and last but not least, some insight into design of experiments, the more traditional way, full factorial of Behnken designs and so on, and the more advanced dynamic optimal experimental design procedures. all included in the book. If you want to stay tuned, these are the details of the book, but you can easily find them pretty soon on the web. Thank you very much for listening. If you have any questions left, I would be pleased to interact with you now during this talk, webinar, or later on via email or by phone, any way you would like. Thank you very much.